My name is Lee Wright, and in addition to being the conductor of First Inversion, I am the director of music here at Downtown United Presbyterian Church. And on behalf of our session and congregation and staff, I welcome you to this space that has been historically inhabited by abolitionists and people who give refuge to people who need it. This is a social justice church where all are welcome, and I am so happy that we are able to have this program in this space with all of you today. Some of you may be aware that a couple years ago in 2018, I guess that's 3 years ago now, but you know, last year doesn't count, we had our first Holding On Through Song concert on the Fringe Festival at the Lyric Theater. And preceding that concert, there was a bit of controversy around the fact that we had a mostly white choir singing American Negro spirituals. And we had a town hall meeting about it. We talked on the radio about it. We discussed it at the concert itself. And as one of the people who originally protested the concert said, he said, you know, we're not ready to sing this music together yet. And I said, maybe not. But the only way we're going to get there is to practice. And so in that spirit, I welcome you today as we travel a road that is far from over, as we live in a place where we are not all equal, but there are so many people working and fighting every day to make this a better place and for us to live more peacefully, more equally, more justly together. So I hope as you hear the program today that you not only enjoy the music, but that you somehow let it change you. And that after this concert, there may just be some part of you, there may be something that you do that is different because of something you heard today. I ask that you hold your applause all the way till the end of the program. We will go from music to reading, to music to dance, to reading, all seamlessly. The program will be without an intermission. It'll be about an hour and 10 minutes. And if you need to slip away to a restroom, please do so between pieces. Hopefully there's a women's room here on the ground floor, men's room on the landing there. There's also an accessible men's room up the ramp this way. Due to the pandemic, we won't have a reception following the concert, but you're welcome to mingle for a little while in the sanctuary following the concert to meet the singers. And I just want to thank you again for joining us for this very important concert. And now, please join me in welcoming, I'll let you clap now, for welcoming First Inversion, Herb Smith, Thomas Warfield, our wonderful soloists, for Holding On Through Song 3.
The breakup of families represented the most painful aspect of sales in the midst and the minds of many slaves. I stayed in this trader's pen 3 days after my new master bought me, and during this time I saw hundreds of mothers separated from their children. I heard the wail of many a child for its mother and of mother for her child. While one buyer had the mother going in one direction, another with the child would be going in the opposite way. They could not have been any darker days to them than these. Linda Brent told the story of a mother and the sale of her seven children. She knew that some of them would be taken from her, but they took all. The children were sold to a slave trader, and the mother was bought by a man in her own town. Before night, children were all far, far away. She begged the trader to tell her where he intended to take them. This he refused to do. How could he, when he knew he would sell them one by one wherever he could command the highest price? I met that mother in the street, and her wild, haggard face lives today in my mind. She wrung her hands in anguish and exclaimed, "Gone! All gone. Why don't God kill me?"
Thank you.
In June 1776, Thomas Jefferson sat at his portable writing desk in a rented room in Philadelphia and penned these words: "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. For the last 243 years, this fierce assertion of the fundamental and natural rights of humankind to freedom and self-governance has defined our global reputation as a land of liberty." As Jefferson composed his inspiring words, however, a teenage boy who would enjoy none of those rights and liberties waited nearby to serve his master's beck and call. His name was Robert Hennings. And he was the half-brother of Jefferson's wife, born to Martha Jefferson's father and a woman he owned. It was common for white enslavers to keep their half-black children in slavery. Jefferson had chosen Hennings from among about 130 enslaved people that would work on the forced labor camp he called Monticello. To occupy him to Philadelphia, to accompany him to Philadelphia, ensure his every comfort as he drafted the text making the case for a new democratic republic based on the individual rights of men.
Oh.
His religion hindered him from breaking the Sabbath, but not from breaking my skin on any other day than Sunday. For a while he would cut and lash my body during the week. He would not hesitate on Sunday to teach me the value of my soul, or the way of life and salvation by Jesus Christ. Frederick Douglass. Eileen Gunther said, in their own words, Slave Life and the Power of Spirituals, real church was the secret church. It might take place on a weeknight or a Sunday evening after the required formal Sunday morning service. Locations varied, in a distant cabin, under a clump of trees, or in a distant gully termed Hush Harbor or Brush Arbor. Slaves risked punishment if they were caught in such meetings. Children might be stationed in treetops as lookouts to whistle a warning should an overseer come close to their meeting place. Participants also hung wet quilts on an overturned iron pot in order to mute the sound of their praying and their singing.
You must have that true religion. You must have your soul converted.
through all the sorrow of sorrow songs, there breathes a hope, a faith in the ultimate justice of things. The minor cadences of despair change often to triumph and calm confidence. Sometimes it is faith in life, sometimes a faith in death, sometimes assurance of boundless justice in some fair world beyond. But whichever it is, the meaning is always clear that sometime, somewhere, men will judge men by their souls and not their skins.
Thank you.
The circumstances in which I was then placed gave me a long desire to be free. It kindled a fire of liberty within my breast which has never yet been quenched. This seemed to be part of my nature. It was just revealed to me by the inevitable laws of nature's God. And I believe then, as I believe now, that every man has a right to wages for his labor, a right to his own wife and children, a right to liberty and the pursuit of happiness, and a right to worship God according to the dictates of his own conscience. I will not stand it. I will not run away, said Frederick Douglass. I'll try it. I had as well die with ague as the fever. I have only one life to lose. I has well be killed running as die standing.
Hallelujah, Savior. Thank you.
published in 1844 by abolitionist George W. Clark, The Liberty Minstrel is a volume of original songs and poetry written to further the cause of abolition by inspiring sympathy in the hearts of Northern whites against the cruelties of slavery. Many of the songs are written in the first person as if coming from the enslaved themselves. Today, the songs could certainly be judged as rude and pretentious imitations of spirituals. However, when placed in historical context, a couple of decades before actual spirituals were first transcribed, they can represent an early attempt at anti-racism, however flawed they may be. Hear these words from the introduction of Clark's volume. An ardent love of humanity, a deep consciousness of the injustice of slavery, a heart full of symphony and sympathy for the oppressed, and a due appreciation of the blessings of freedom has given birth to the poetry comprised in this volume. I have long desired to see these sentiments of love, of sympathy, of justice and humanity so beautifully expressed in poetic measure, embalmed in sweet music, so that all the people, the rich, the poor, the young and the old, who have hearts to feel and tongues to move, may sing of the wrongs of slavery and the blessings of liberty, until every human being shall recognize in his fellow an equal, a man and a brother, until by familiarity with these sentiments and their influence upon their hearts, the people whose duty it is shall undo the heavy burdens and let the oppressed go free. Let associations of singers having love of liberty in their hearts be immediately formed in every community. Let them study thoroughly and make themselves perfectly familiar with both the poetry and the music, and enter into the sentiment of the piece they are to perform, that they may impress it upon their hearers. Above all things, let the enunciation of every word be clear and distinct. Most of the singing of the present day is entirely too artificial, stiff, and mechanical. It should be easy and natural, flowing directly from the soul of the performer without affectation or display. And then singing will answer its true end and not only please the ear, but affect and improve the heart. To the true friends of universal freedom, the Liberty Minstrel is respectfully dedicated. New York, October 1844, G.W. Clark. First Inversion wishes to dedicate this performance of My Child Is Gone in loving memory of our dear friend, singer, supporter, and beautifully imperfect anti-racist, Dr. Michael Gale. Michael first sang these arrangements in college, and it moved him so that he remembered it through his whole life and was able to find the scores so that First Inversion could sing it now. a slave, had often heard his master's minister talk about heaven, the final abode of the righteous. Naturally, the master regarded himself as fitting into that category. On the other hand, the slave knew that he too was going to heaven. He reasoned, there must be two separate heavens. No, this could not be true, because there is only one God. God cannot be divided in this way. I have it. I am having my hell now. When I die, I shall have my heaven. The master is having his heaven now. When he dies, he will have his hell. The next day, chopping cotton beneath the torrid skies, the slave said to his mate, I got shoes. You got shoes. All God's children got shoes. When we get to heaven, we're going to put on our shoes and shout all over God's heaven. Heaven! Heaven! Then looking up at the big house where the master lived, he said, but everybody talking about heaven ain't going there.
Yes.
now that you're on your feet, you can stay there to sing with us. We are going to close this evening in the tradition of African-American group song, call and response. The song is called Over My Head. There is music in the air, and there must be a God somewhere.